It goes like this. There's not another soul righteous. A plague struck us like a boxing pro's tight fist. Hearts are cold like ice is. You know what the price is. Separation like a divorce.
Hello there. This is the show where the guy who does What Shall I Cry Ministries does a podcast. I'm here with my trusty sidekick, Brad, the shape-shifting vision casting leader. Say hi, Brad.
Yes! What's going on?
We're just doing a podcast. We've got a big show lined up for you today. I know every podcast says that, and now I'm saying it. It's not that big, actually. It's pretty good. It's not, like, great. I'd say it's so-so. What was that movie back years ago with Dudley Moore in it, Brad?
Netflix and Chill.
I think it had Daryl Hannah in it.
Across all campuses, let's see the hands of those who love romance movies.
It was about this advertising guy who has a nervous breakdown because of all the stress in the ad game, and he goes to a mental institution and meets these other patients, and they start their own ad agency where they tell the truth in their ads, you know, like...
Buy Volvos. They're boxy, but they're good.
Yeah, and it got really popular. It turned out the public really responded well to truth in advertising.
What?
So, no, we don't have a big show lined up for you today, but we do have a show lined up for you today. We'll cop to that. That show where the guy who does What Shall I Cry Ministries, it's everything you want in a show and less. That's our new slogan. Anyway, we've got today a sneak peek at Real Talk Kim lined up for you. We're going to be taking a look at Bethel Church's Confession of Repentance from Poverty, and we're going to take a look at Matthew 18 as it relates to this ministry. But before we do any of that, let's have this quick word from one of our sponsors. How many times has this happened to you?
What's wrong, dear?
It's Saturday night, and I don't have anything to preach. I've already done all the popular movies out now. I've done all the popular television shows. We finished up the Billboard Top 40 series. I did the gamer thing already. I just don't know what to do.
Tired of not having anything relevant to preach to your congregation? Well, get ready to get untired, because I've got some good news. New from What Shall I Cry Ministries, it's the Epistle of 1 Peter. It's chock full of relevant topics for the 21st century congregant. It's got immigration, sanctification, Old Testament exegesis, suffering, election, fellowship of the saints, ecclesiology, culture, government, eschatology, politics, labor reform, imputation, marriage counseling, body image, atonement, finances, and best of all, God wrote it.
You know, he's right. This first epistle of Peter is great. It's way better than Avengers Infinity War. It's short. It's concise, and, you know, it's almost like it's actually written directly to the church. But...
What's wrong now?
Well, now I have something to preach, but I don't know what I'm going to wear tomorrow.
Suit and tie not included. What Shall I Cry Ministries is not on the first epistle of Peter. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work.
We interrupt our program to bring you this important message.
Welcome to Bible Q&A with John MacArthur. This is Denny Nugent with another question for Dr. MacArthur. When unbelievers are caught in a sin and confronted about it, they'll often quote the words of Jesus from Matthew 7:1, "Judge not, lest you be judged." John, is that the right application of that verse?
You know, Denny, that is the unbeliever's favorite verse. Judge not, lest you be judged. What is so interesting about that verse is in the same place in Matthew chapter 7 where our Lord said, judge not, lest you be judged. He then immediately said, don't cast your pearls before swine, and don't give what is holy to dogs. Wow. If that's true, if you're not supposed to waste divine treasures on dogs and pigs, you got to make a judgment of who's a dog and who's a pig. That's discernment. You're not going to waste the glories of the gospel on people like wild pigs would tear it to shreds. So what he means by judge not lest you be judged does not mean that you're not supposed to evaluate people What it does mean is you're not the final judge. You don't render the final verdict. And the Pharisees and the scribes in Judaism had set themselves up as the divine judges, the final court, and they were rendering their personal judgment on people as if they were God. We don't have the right to do that. Discern, yes. Evaluate, yes. In fact, discernment is critical in knowing how to deal with people with the gospel, but we're not the final judge.
We now return to the real Ghostbusters.
I hear that a lot in the comments. They say, you should really go to this person in private before you criticize them in public. I don't think any of them have ever cited a biblical passage for this, but I assume they're referring to Matthew 18, verses 15 through 18.
I mean, here's my Bible, and so we might as well.
Jesus says, if your brother sins, go and show him his fault in private. If he listens to you, you have won your brother. But if he does not listen to you, take one or two more with you, so that by the mouth of two or three witnesses every fact may be confirmed. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Please note that verse 18, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven, is in the context of church discipline. It's not in the context of binding your ex-husband to stop bad-mouthing you or loosing the bank to give you that interest-free loan. I submit here that Jesus is talking about secret sin, how to keep secret sin out of the church. These must be private sins that he's referring to, because if they were known to the church, what need would there be to address this person in private? In the first epistle of the Corinthians, Paul writes in 5:11, now remember, this is a letter written to the church expressly about the topic of church discipline. 1 Corinthians 5:11, Paul says, but now I am writing to you not to associate with anyone who bears the name of brother if he is guilty of sexual immorality or greed, or is an idolater, reviler, drunkard, or swindler, not even to eat with such a one. So how do we know who is committing sexual immorality or greed or drunkenness in these things Paul lists? How do we know who not to associate with? Must we maintain absolute surveillance on everyone in the church? That's impossible. So how do we obey this command in 1 Corinthians 5? Well, we go back to what Jesus said. If you see a brother in sin, if you, for example, see your brother coming out of a strip club, you don't go to the church and say, hey, so-and-so goes to strip clubs, let's kick him out of the church. No, you go to him in private. If he listens to you and repents, all is well. There is no need to make this known to the church because he has repented. He is no longer a person who indulges in this kind of activity. If he does not repent, you go to two or three other brothers and then you confront him. If he still does not repent, you take it before the church, and if he does not listen to the church, he is to be treated as an unbeliever. And according to 1 Corinthians 5:11, he is thus marked as one who does not participate in the fellowship of Christ's body. Now, as a side note, that does not mean that he is treated as some kind of pariah, but what it does mean is that every engagement with him must therefore be preceded by the knowledge that this is an unregenerate person, and he must be engaged with as one who is lost. If you notice this list of sins, Paul mentions sexual immorality, greed, drunkenness, swindling. These are all actions. They are private deeds done in private, and they need to be brought to the attention of the church. But when we talk about teaching, we're not talking about private deeds or actions. A teaching is presented to the body. It is not done behind closed doors in the back room of some sleazy bar. Now, what is taught in the local body of any church is the business of that local body. I don't go sneaking in the churches like some spy trying to figure out what's being taught there. That is between them, their leadership, and God. But YouTube is not a church. It is teaching that is presented beyond the scope of a local body. It is literally teaching done in the public marketplace. Anyone passing by can hear it. Lost people can hear it. it is presented not to a covenant body, but to the world at large. If a man presents false doctrine on YouTube and I go to that man and say, hey, you're not speaking the truth, even if that man repents, the doctrine is still out there in the minds and hearts of the lost. This is why public teaching that is false is rebuked in public, before the same ears that have heard the error. I remember one time I was at the national park and there was this guy standing there with a table and some books and a collection jar, and as I passed, he offered me some literature. Sensing that he was with some kind of a cult, I said, no thank you, we're Christians. I walked on past him, but then he said, hey, me too, I'm Christian. Oh yeah, man, we're all about Jesus here. So I came back and said, right on, man, and dropped a couple of dollars into his jar and took a pamphlet and started walking again. I was a few steps away and there was another man, and he was preaching against this first man, who I found out was a Hare Krishna. This second man was physically warning the same public that this Hare Krishna was trying to deceive. Now, if he'd just gone over to this Hare Krishna and said, you know, you and I need to have a talk in private about what you're telling the public, how would that have benefited me? It would not have. The biblical principle is this: sin is dealt with where it is committed. If it is committed in private, it is dealt with in private. And only when not properly dealt with in private is it brought before the public. Public sin is dealt with in the public. Jesus rebuked the teaching of the Pharisees in public, even after he told his disciples this in Matthew 18. And you'll notice the disciples never came to Jesus and said, you know, you really should have talked to them in private before you started criticizing them in public. Now, it is not my intent to bash these people or to be unkind. I try to limit my criticism to what is being taught. I can assure you there are lots of preachers and teachers out there that I do not agree with many of the things they do. How they dress, for example, or the kind of worship they have instituted in their church, things like that. But I don't criticize them because they consistently preach the gospel. I care a whole lot less about whether or not a pastor wears skinny jeans than whether or not he is consistently preaching the gospel. Paul even said in one of his epistles, the specific one escapes me now, but that there were those who were criticizing him, even making his life difficult, but that they should not be hindered because at least they are preaching the true gospel. I would submit that neither I nor any of these teachers I criticize is above the Apostle Paul. He was able to tolerate the criticism of others for the sake of the gospel. I pray that I too might be made that humble by the Holy Spirit. So when you evaluate any teacher, whether it's me or anyone else, ask yourself, does this teacher consistently teach the gospel? Does he consistently proclaim the good news that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures and was raised by God according to the scriptures? If I ever get to the point where that is not the focus of my teaching, then turn this channel off and get as far away from me as you possibly can. Not only that, warn everyone you know to stay as far away from me and this channel as they possibly can. In Galatians, Paul said, if I or anyone else bring another gospel to you, let them be accursed. Don't put your trust in someone who is cursed. Put your trust in the one who bore your curse on Calvary's tree, our Lord and our God, our Savior, our hope and trust, Jesus Christ.
Get that in your spirit.
Now here's something we hope you'll really like.
I don't know what you feel about the prosperity gospel, the health, wealth, and prosperity gospel, but I'll tell you what I feel about it. Hatred. It is not the gospel. And it's being exported from this country to Africa and Asia, selling a bill of goods to the poorest of the poor. Believe this message, your pigs won't die, your wife won't have miscarriages, you have rings on your fingers and coats on your back. That's coming out of America. The people that ought to be giving our money and our time and our lives, instead selling them a bunch of crap called gospel. And here's the reason it is so horrible. When was the last time that any American, African, Asian ever said, Jesus is all satisfying because you drove a BMW. Never. They'll say, Jesus give you that? Yeah, well, I'll take Jesus. That's idolatry. That's not the gospel. That's elevating gifts above giver. I'll tell you what makes Jesus look beautiful is when you smash your car and your little girl goes flying through the windshield and lands like dead on the street. And you say, through the deepest possible pain, God is enough. God is enough. He is good. He will take care of us. He will satisfy us. He will get us through this. He is our treasure. Whom have I in heaven but you? And on earth, there's nothing that I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart, my little girl may fail, but you are the strength of my heart and my portion forever. That makes God look glorious. As God, not as giver of cars or safety or health. Oh, how I pray that America would be purged of the health, wealth, and prosperity gospel, and that the Christian church would be marked by suffering for Christ. God is most glorified in you when you are most satisfied in Him in the midst of loss, not prosperity.
This is a test. This station is conducting a test of the emergency broadcasting system. This is only a test.
So, at my church, we're going through the Baptist London Confession of 1689. It got me to wondering if maybe some of these other churches that we examine here on this channel are confessional churches. And it turns out Bethel Church in Redding, California is a confessional church. As it happens, I found their confession in one of their services. So just take a listen.
Well, I'd like for us to read together offering number, I believe it's 4 tonight. Let's say this together tonight. As we pray for new wells of revival, we pray for new economic wells in Redding to be created.
Show me the money.
So Lord, we ask you for favor for our city with CEOs, government leaders, and kings, firms that produce goods for the nations and provide new jobs for our people, technology to establish new markets, energy sources, and efficient solutions to grow as a population, laws and courts that measure with the justice and the freedom of our land's constitution, civil servants that encourage entrepreneurs, and a media known for wisdom and truth. Released, harvested, sold, and reproduced. Education, books, and universities that develop mind molders who influence the influential. Capital to build small businesses.
Come on, give me some money, man. Just give me some money.
That provides services, arts, and culture, attracting both young and old. Medical community known for integrity and excellence. Repentance from poverty.
No, ma'am, I'm afraid that's not allowed. Help me, I'm poor. No.
Repentance from poverty.
I am not poor.
Small thinking and envy. Courage to recognize opportunities and make wealth. Abundance to bless the world and the prudence to save and invest. Revelation to pass on wealth to our children's children. So we declare that when the righteous prosper, the city rejoices. Hallelujah.
I didn't get a harumph out of that guy.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special report.
Don't believe people who tell you that God will keep you from all suffering or that God will bring you out of suffering really quickly. That's false hope. It abounded in Jeremiah's day and it is abounding today. in the mouths of prophets then and in the mouths of preachers today all across our country. Please hear me loud and clear. Many of the fastest growing churches in our country today are built on this false hope. I was having a conversation recently about one church that draws tens of thousands of people, and they say explicitly, I quote, "It is God's will for every believer to become whole, healthy, and successful in every area of life." They claim that on the cross, Jesus bought for us not just spiritual provision, but physical provision and financial provision. So this is not just out there teaching. This is mainstream common teaching that is drawing supposedly Christian crowds. And not just here, all around the world. Many of the fastest supposedly Christian churches and movements and supposedly Christian books are built on teaching that says God wills for you to be healthy, wealthy, and prosperous in this world. God wills to keep you from all suffering if only you will trust in Him, have faith in Him. And if by chance, for some reason, you find yourself in suffering, maybe even because of a lack of faith, if you will only return to God in faith, your suffering will end in a short time. Believe this. Claim this. Trust that prosperity is coming. Tell yourself this. Power of positive thinking even. Have faith. In Jeremiah 29:11, God says, "I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you." God wills to prosper you financially, physically, otherwise. And if you're suffering right now, you need to believe that prosperity is coming soon, because that's what Jeremiah 29:11 teaches, right? When in reality, Jeremiah 29:11 teaches the exact opposite. God's people were in exile according to God's will. And according to God's word, their suffering in exile was not coming to an end anytime soon. Now, you might think, I like the other message better. Which is exactly what the people in Jeremiah's day were thinking. It's why they were believing these false prophets. And God is saying to us right now the exact same thing He was saying to them then. Don't believe it. Don't put your hope in crowd-pleasing words. Why? Because they're not from God. Jeremiah, the prophet who is speaking the word of God, says, here is true hope. Follow this. Your hope is not that God wills to keep you from all suffering. That's not at all what Jeremiah 29:11 teaches. Jeremiah 29:11 teaches that God wills to bring you through all suffering. We've seen this. Like, context of Jeremiah 29 makes crystal clear that suffering is a reality for God's people in this fallen world, and God's people will not escape it. But God says to His people, in the middle of suffering, I promise to enable you to endure it. And God does not promise in His word that suffering will end in a short time. That is a false hope that has led all kinds of people astray, preachers or Christians, saying, if you just believe, have faith, you will be healed soon. If you just have faith, believe, you will have financial health soon. If you just believe, your marriage will be reconciled soon. Name it, claim it, believe it, receive it. And then, when it doesn't happen, when the healing doesn't come, when the finances aren't there, when the divorce becomes final, people are left wondering, did I not have enough faith? Or worse, is God actually there? Or if He is there, can He actually be trusted? When God never in His word promised that your suffering would end in a short time.
You might ask, well, did God promise anything along these lines? And the answer, though not as popular, is clear here in Jeremiah 29:11. True hope, God promises your suffering will end in the long term. Exile will not be the end for you, God tells his people. Your suffering will not have the last word. I have good plans for you, God says, and my good plan is guaranteed to prevail in the end. Do you realize what this means? What it meant for God's people in Jeremiah 29 and what it means for us as God's people today? God's plan calls for patient trust. 70 years is a long time to wait. Most of us would like God to work out our problems by the end of the week, not the end of the century. Which is why these false prophets were so appealing then, and it's why prosperity teaching is so popular today. But it's not true. It's a lie. What's true is that God is calling his people through his word, through this word, to patient trust. Is it possible that suffering could end soon in this or that situation? And healing, reconciliation, whatever might happen? Absolutely. By the grace and power of God, it is. And we can and should pray for that. But is it guaranteed? Absolutely, it is not. You can't bank your life on that. God hasn't said that, no matter how good it sounds. And I'm not going to say it as your pastor, no matter how many crowds it brings or doesn't bring. What God says is that when suffering comes, sometimes suffering stays.
We can leave that out, can't we?
So a lot of you have asked me to check out Real Talk Kim, and I did. And I came to the conclusion that y'all must really hate me. So anyway, you asked for it. Here it comes.
Some of you have walked in here with some heavy stuff on you, and God said, I'm ready to take it off of you.
Did he? Did he say that? When did he say this? And to whom did he say this? And what was his exact words? Because whenever we see prophets and apostles speaking for God, they always quoted him directly. Because, you know, in Deuteronomy 18, God says, anyone who misquotes him shall be put to death. And what's with the music in the background? Did you download this from God's playlist?
See, what the enemy does is he brings us into an atmosphere like this.
Feeling lightheaded yet?
Uh-uh.
And he puts fear in you.
Remember this?
He puts worry in you.
It's free.
He puts the shoulda, couldas, and wouldas in you. But how many people in this building today can say I'm right where I'm supposed to be? And I'm gonna praise my way. I'm gonna praise my way. I'm gonna praise my way into victory. V-I-C-T-O-R-Y.
Victory over what exactly?
So Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for what you're doing in this house on the last Sunday of 2019.
Is she praying or what? Does God not know what day it is?
We about, you know what? We may not be having no jets and flights taking us to the grocery store, but we got a Holy Spirit.
Is that who the Holy Spirit is to you? A spaceship to take you places?
That is our Holy Ghost juice.
Holy Ghost juice. Isn't it ironic that those who talk the most about the Holy Spirit seem to speak the most irreverently about him? I mean, these are the kind of folks that criticize someone like John MacArthur, saying, oh, he doesn't have the Holy Spirit. But can you imagine John MacArthur saying something like Holy Ghost juice?
So just let him lift you today in your spirits. Lift us in this place, Father. We thank you. Come on, I just need some of you just to press in for a second. I got a good word for you today. But unless you get to a place where you disconnect from what you walked in with.
That's like 17 words. I lost count.
You won't be able to receive that word.
But which word? And what if I walked in with my wife? Should I disconnect from my wife?
The enemy has stolen so many words from you.
Do you have your own words? Hey, I'm using the ones everybody else has been using.
And breakthroughs from,
from
you, because you can't tame your mind.
So we're supposed to have tamed mind. Let's listen and see if the person telling us to tame our minds has a tamed mind.
Where you are right now is no surprise to God. He's already graced you with everything that you need to break out of that place.
Today.
Somebody just needs to lift their voice today and just say, I'm free. I'm free. I'm free.
Free from what? I'm, you know, trying to tame my mind here. Trying to tame it to maybe, I don't know, not just blindly repeat what people tell me to.
No longer bound. I'm free.
No longer bound by what? I am bound to Christ, irrevocably. I need a little context before I start blindly repeating what people tell me to repeat.
I'm free. Some of you need to tell your face, I'm free. I'm free. Worry, I'm free. I ain't worrying. I'm a worshiper. I'm not pitiful, I'm powerful. I'm not broken, I'm beautifully broken.
I'm a sinner being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. Is that okay to say?
So Father, we thank you for your presence. In Jesus' name.
I guess she was praying. I mean, she put Jesus' name after it.
And singers, good Lord.
You know better than that. You ought not say that word.
Y'all better give it up for our Holy Ghost-filled singers and musicians and... Like that dude right there, man. I'm taking him home with me.
Yeah, that seems mildly inappropriate for...
I'm gonna take all y'all home with me. All y'all just come sit in my living room. I'll move on my couches. Y'all already think y'all can't handle me. Can you imagine? Y'all think I have crack for breakfast.
I was guessing meth, but, you know, whatever. I have some experience with meth addicts. They do tend to ramble on nonsensically.
I have Holy Ghost crack.
Holy Ghost crack. Now, again, can you imagine these non-Holy Spirit having preachers like John MacArthur ever saying anything like this?
Something happens when you get free, baby. Something happens when you get free. We want to welcome you to Church of the Harvest, Fayetteville. This is the last Sunday. Y'all know what's about to happen? What's about to happen? I can't hear you. I can't hear you.
I didn't get a harumph out of that guy.
And y'all, you can't say, we're going to Limitless. We're not walking in 2020 like that. You got to be dropping the whole mic. Like, we Limitless, baby. Like, I could just walk up into a room and I'm Limitless.
Well, hello, Mr. Fancy Pants.
I'm walking into atmospheres.
Stop laughing at me.
Where I didn't fit at tables, and I'm about to build my own table because I'm limitless. All those doors that closed on me in the last decade, I'm going back to buy the whole doggone building.
No, I buy you out. You don't buy me out.
Limitless.
Do you know who I am?
Limitless.
That's like a tired record. You only have about six things you say.
Y'all ready to give? Y'all ready to give? I can't hear you.
Profit deal.
This is one of the greatest parts of the service because this is what loosens your finances.
You got some light fingers, Everett.
All God asks of you is 10 cents on a dollar.
Gopher.
Y'all gonna go to Dollar Tree and spend $100. Like, how they do that? How does a Dollar Tree always get you for like $50 when it's a Dollar Tree? They psych you out. So you can get your offering. Hi, sweet girl. How you doing?
Squirrel.
Y'all look at your neighbor and say, man, you are the prettiest one in this room. Tell your neighbor, girl, bro, I just did a Holy Ghost hookup for somebody.
I take that back. I don't think she's been smoking meth or crack. I know meth heads who wouldn't dare use such imagery and language regarding the Holy Spirit. They have enough fear of the Lord, even as meth heads.
There's five ways that you can give. You can get by cash. And if you want to get by cash, we got all these pretty women walking around giving you an envelope.
You know, a lot of cults send pretty girls out to do their evangelizing. Seriously, it's called flirty fishing. I'm not saying that's what this is. I'm just saying that's what a lot of cults do.
Why do we want you to put an envelope, even if it's just a dollar? Yeah, we ain't walking into 2020 wadding up a dollar in our hand because we don't want nobody to see what we give it. You proudly give what you got, right? And you don't want the tax man to get all your money, so I get to give you a tax write-off every time you sow into this place.
So how many pounds was the rose that won last year?
Pounds? Is that a joke?
No. I mean, I saw that pumpkin on the news they had to carry out on a forklift. Bigger is better at these things, right?
Yo, I'm so excited because we're not just changing our name, but we're getting some vision.
If we're wrong about you, if you're the monster that Ultron made you to be, what will you do?
Like, I won't literally by January or February, we knocking this wall out. Y'all want to do it with me?
Oh, yeah.
Y'all want to do it with me? Ain't y'all sick of sitting on top of each other? I gotta give it to y'all, man. Y'all like sitting on each other. Y'all getting each other's juice on, you know, like love juice.
What is this worship service rated?
Man, we got everywhere. Y'all need to help us grow. Who's gonna help me grow in 2020? I can't see you. I'm looking at you. Who gonna help me grow? Who's gonna help love people back to life?
Well, I understood that one word, grew, but...
I can't see you. Y'all should be excited about this. If y'all ready to give, you can everybody stand up on your feet. I'm gonna give you one last time to get yourself, get all that energy out, because I'm about to preach. Y'all can come on up. As you're coming up, I'm praying. Father, we just thank you for this offering. We thank you for everybody that's given. We pray for the people that can't, that don't have to give, but they want to give. I thank you that 2020 is gonna be a year they could build the whole building for me, huh? I just prophesy millionaires in here.
Is she still praying, or is she prophesying, or what?
I prophesied billionaires in here.
Tell me something good.
I prophesy trillionaires in here.
Well, now you're just talking crazy. I'm billionaires, sure, but trillionaires? Come on, that's a little much.
I thank you, Lord, that we are the first CEOs in our family. I thank you, Lord, that we are the first ones breaking generational curses off our family.
Hey, witch doctor, give us the magic words.
I thank you, Lord, that we are making some inventions this year, whether it be a toilet seat where our tails don't fall in the toilet, or a clean itself toilet seat, whatever.
I don't know what to say.
We thank you for witty ideas that's going to make us a lot of money on Shark Tank.
Is she still talking to us, or to God, or to herself, or to her spirit self? What is going on here? Am I watching a crazy person?
We just thank you for favor. Start up the dreams on the inside of us, God.
Get in my belly!
Lord, anything that we've walked in with that is broken, that we feel stuck, we just give it to you right now. Some of y'all need to give that shame to him. Some of y'all need to give that sadness to him. Come on, you got to give it to God. You got to clear out your mind right now.
That's culty talk. As Christians, we don't clear out our minds. We fill them with God's word. What you're looking at here is an empty mind. This that's going on, this is the fruit of an empty mind. And I don't say that to be cruel. I say it just as a matter of fact. This is an empty mind you're watching here. It is not full of the word of God. It's vacuous. She told us to tame our minds earlier. Now she's telling us to empty them. I don't know whether to close the barn door or keep it open.
And say, Father, I receive the word on today. I receive my miracles. I receive my blessings, and I dare you to open your mouth in here and decree and declare my heart is healed, my mind is sound, my soul is blessed, my family is chosen, my body is healthy, my future is fantastic.
Why would I declare those things if they're not true? My shoulder hurts right now. It's hurting right now. It's an old construction injury. It really hurts, but you know, I'm not dying or anything. What are you telling me? You telling me to lie? Real talk, Kim? Is that what you're telling me?
My words are anointed.
Do you know what it means to be anointed? It means you are speaking the words of the Anointed One, and that would be Christ Jesus. Are you speaking his words, real talk, Kim? Because I don't remember him or any of his apostles telling me to declare things that aren't true. I don't recall them talking about Holy Ghost hookups or self-cleaning toilets either. As a matter of fact, I don't recall them saying anything you've said in the last, what is it, like 10 minutes of this, whatever it is.
My walk is righteous.
How so? In what sense? I thought you were beautifully broken. Didn't you tell us to say that earlier? I'm beautifully broken.
My praise is dangerous.
Are those the anointed words of Christ? Because I don't remember him saying that in Scripture.
My destiny is unstoppable.
It is your destiny.
In 2020, I'm coming for you.
Get in my belly.
I'm coming for you. Boom shakalaka, lakalaka, boom.
Well, that's enough of that for now. I think that's about all I can take. But she's getting ready to, wait, how did she put it? Getting ready to...
'Cause I'm about to preach!
Yeah, so we'll pick up there tomorrow. You know, one of the things that's important to this ministry is to analyze the things people say when they say things. One of the downfalls of that is you have to actually wait for someone to say something before you can analyze it. She didn't say anything, so that's when I didn't talk much. I just kind of sat there with my mouth agape. So anyway, we'll pick up later with the sermon, I guess, or whatever's coming next. My producer tells me we've got a couple of minutes. That's a joke. I don't have a producer. Go read the Gospel of John. Read it again. It never gets old. It was written so that we might believe on him the Father sent, the Son of God, so that we might have eternal life. Until then, I'll see you later.